Hi, this is Sam Small with rather an extraordinary episode of Maui Causes. This episode is shot down here on Mokulele Highway, where the Maui community has taken a stand against the construction going up on Haleakala. They've attempted to block the three trucks from bringing heavy material up to the volcano summit. We'll bring that to you here on Maui Causes.
We made it very clear to the National Science Foundation, to the Institute for Astronomy, that what was happening on the top of the mountain was a desecration. If the tourist industry wanted to build a 14-story hotel on this island, they couldn't do it. If we wanted to build a 14-story educational structure on this island, we would not be allowed to do it. So it just struck us that something was wrong when permits were going to be issued for a 14-story solar telescope atop Haleakala. The millions, multi-millions of dollars that the National Science Foundation was willing to sink into this were overwhelming. Why the Board of Land and Natural Resources would approve permits on conservation district land that have 8 criteria that need to be met. We feel that these projects don't fulfill those criteria, and that's the crux of the Supreme Court cases right now.
Itself still belongs to our people. Our people never gave up consent to the top of the mountain. These are lands that are part of our Hawaiian kingdom and crown lands that were confiscated and illegally claimed, and unlawfully claimed, really. We know that the state of Hawaii, who took control of those lands in 1959, they have no title to those lands. But in 1961, through executive order, Governor Quinn, these lands were passed to the University of Hawaii to create a science city at the top of the mountain, again, without the consent and without the confirmation from our people. You know, through the years, we've been resisting. This is not the first time we've been resisting this attempt, but at this point in history, our people are strong enough and ready enough and standing to resist, and that's really what you're going to see tonight. And so, as we said, you know, it's their choice. We're just reacting to their actions. You know, we don't want to do this at all. That's not our choice. But because they refuse to acknowledge our human rights and they refuse to acknowledge our humanity as a people, refuse to acknowledge that our people never gave consent to what's going on the mountain. At this point, we have no choice to resist and do whatever is necessary. And for me, it's no different than genetically modified food farming in Hawaii. It's the same thing. People of Maui voted. And all we wanted to say was, make sure it's safe before you use it. That's it. Very simple. See, my point is, this is very related. And yet, it goes on. It goes on because they have the power to ignore the people. But that somehow corporations like Monsanto have that kind of divinity almost, or have this kind of sense of godliness that they can do whatever they want, even at the expense of the people. You know, so people on Maui, for example, whether it's genetically modified foods, whether it's mass tourism, whether it's the diversion of our streams, you know, these kinds of environmental crimes that are daily occurrence here in Hawaii, along with the desecration of mountains, are really the same, it's the same mentality we're fighting against. Yeah? And so, you know, for me, self-determination is a key issue here. The protection of the people's rights to the humanity is also an important issue here. And of course, the protection of the environment is also an issue here. So, you know, those are all really why we as Hawaiians, through the ideology of Aloha Aina, your love and appreciation and compassion for the land, leads us to do whatever is necessary to come to here today to do whatever we have to do. So,
and that's tied to yesterday's action.
Of course, the TPP that we just had a protest on the beach. It's all really part of the same mentality, in a sense, like
same
the TPP. Same process. Very secretive. The idea that the 1% of the 1% can determine for the rest of the 99.9% how things are going to be. That somehow their values, their desires outweigh our needs and our humanity. So, you know, to me, it's very similar. Basically, it is the same issue that's going on.
It's all tied together.
It's all tied. I mean, again, local self-determination. So that's why we're here, to do whatever we need to do. So,
thank you for doing
okay,
it.
Brother?
Yep.
Good. Okay.
Hi, are you okay?
I'm fine.
Do you need a minute?
We had about two lines of people with their arms in PVC pipes. They got through the first line, so we have a second line that they are going to saw off the pipe. And then I think we have a couple of people behind that. So we're hoping that it takes long enough.
And the young girls that were taped?
Yes. So there weren't enough pipes. But they were adamant that they wanted to, you know, kupa'a I ke aloha aina, and they just used the tape because we were out of pipes. They've arrested all of the adults that were in the pipes, and they're actually in the van over there.
But they let the girls go?
They released one minor to me, yes. She was my niece.
All in the family.
Right.
And peaceful? This is...
It's very... I mean, we've always been peaceful, yeah. You know, but we are...
It's kind of festive.
Right, but we're stern about the idea that we don't want this to happen, and we're going to do whatever we... You know, what we can do to stop them. We're serious about the issue. But you know, we stand in kapu aloha, meaning that it's about aloha. We treat people with respect. And they've been treating us with respect also.
I see the strength of all these people here. And I'm proud. I'm very proud.
And it's peaceful.
It is. It is. I mean, we're still in aloha. Those that are coming and joining us are it's like spreading like wildfire, that feeling. And I question those officers who are Kaiapuni Ohana, who have keiki that go to the immersion schools here on Maui, because we don't teach our keiki this. You know, and I wonder to myself, what are they going to tell their keiki about tonight when they speak to them tomorrow? Because I know what I'm going to tell my keiki. And I know that my keiki is in this land, and I know what she's going to tell me. And she's going to tell me that what we've done tonight is pono.
Oh,
associated with Maui.
You feel like this is accomplishment to you?
Tonight, no.
Kapu aloha.
It's unfortunate.
Yeah. Is this hard?
Of course.
What are you feeling?
I think we're not going to really say anything until we see how things work out. We can maybe release a message in the morning.
And the project?
I think we'll talk in the morning.
You feel the project is justified with all the resistance?
Yeah, I think we'll talk in the morning. We'll send out the message.
There's more to our show in just a moment. This program is brought to you as a public service by Maui Causes. Maui Causes is a crowd-funded media production group that provides media production services to a variety of environmental and progressive causes here in Maui County. Visit us on the web at www.mauicauses.org.
What would you like for them to do?
We like for them to actually number one would be to actually wait to the completion of the Supreme Court decision, and then two, you know, for me personally, you know, it's the beginning of the decommission of the telescope, starting with the ATST, which is a $300 million project at this point, funded through the National Science Foundation, through the University of Hawaii. But let me give you an example of the head person of the National Science Foundation. About 6 years, I had a direct conversation with when they were in the process of planning this development. And I asked him directly, straight to his face, and I said, you know, his name was Craig Foltz. And I asked Mr. Foltz, and I said, as Gandhi said, you know, science without humanity is a sin. So I asked him, I said directly, can you tell me what is the humanity of this project? What is it about this project that as a Hawaiian, I can feel good about in regards to humanity? Are you gonna feed people? Are you gonna house people? What's gonna happen? And his direct response to me, directly in my face, was, Kalekoa, it's pure selfish research. And that was his explanation, meaning telling me basically, F you, Kalekoa, we do it because we can, we do it because we want to. And we really have no concern what you guys are saying about the importance of the mountain. And again, you know, this guy's representing a people 5,000 miles away in a true colonial-like fashion. Somehow he still believes that he really has, really, the audacity to think that he has a say on what should happen on our mountain, you know, mountain of Haleakala. So, you know, again, this is just a response to the kind of mentality that's, it's really racist, supremacist mentality by people like Craig Foltz, who kind of believe that they can do whatever they want in places like Hawaii without the concern or without even the recognition of our humanity as a people here in Hawaii. So that's really what this is about, Hawaiians standing up for our own humanity, human rights for our people.
Some of the activities up on top of the mountain that they do,
It's been going on again since 1961. But, you know, besides the solar telescope, we also, of course, have the Air Force has a Maui Space Surveillance system up there. And it's the largest Department of Defense telescope.
And they're looking for aliens? What are they?
They're looking for, I'm assuming they're looking for, as I understand, they track every non-natural, they track every human-made object that's in the sky. That's my understanding. Which of course was also put up them by them, but so it's a military endeavor, and that's besides other telescopes that are out there. Just like Mauna Kea, you know, these are people not from Hawaii, people who come from all over the world to fatten their pockets and, you know, tickle their brain in a way, have no care about the everyday common person who lives here. As I say, you know, they can see all the stars in the skies, but they cannot see the blue tarps on the beaches. You know, they live in nice, comfortable positions or jobs, fattening their belly, looking at the skies at night, when many people still go hungry in places like Hawaii. And so, you know, they talk about education, yet our people are still miseducated in our own island. So, you know, it's really about their own education, their fattening, their own curiosities. Their curiosities outweigh our humanity as a people. And that's really what's going on here. You know, so I say we have really no choice but to, as a people, to rise up and resist the further desecration of the mountain, which is really a desecration of us as a people. And to me, this is just the beginning. You know, when you look at what's been going on, this is really just, you know, along with Mauna Kea, this is really just a beginning of many more struggles to come. So, you know, this is just a little taste of what will come in the future.
Right. Do you think that there's any middle ground where we're all
I mean, I would say middle ground would be just recognize us as human beings. Recognize that we have a right to determine for ourselves. Self-determination belongs to all peoples. All peoples have a right to determine for them. I mean, you know, the examples, of course, is, you know, I would expect the Japanese would have a right to define what happens to Mount Fuji. Or the people of Palestine or Israel have a right to determine what happens in Galata or the sacred mountains and their lands. Or Mount Zion. I mean, I would think that all peoples, again, have that right to determine for themselves what's best for their own people. But when you have that kind of imposition, it's kind of colonial mentality, supremacist mentality, which is the basis that their view of the world outweighs ours. And just give me another example. When I had a conversation with one of the scientists about Mauna Kea, and I asked him directly, I said, what gives you the right to come to our mountain to do what you want to do on our mountain? Where does it come from? And he basically turned to me and said, well, it's no longer your mountain, it's our mountain. And I said, what do you mean our mountain? He says, well, Haleakala, it belongs to the world now. But I think, see, that's the mentality. He believes he speaks for the world, first of all. Right. He believes somehow that his science and his belief, he speaks for our whole world, when in fact, we are part of the world. And if it's anybody should determine what happens for Hawaii, it should start with our people. We should have that determination. And what I said, you know, I'm not against telescopes per se. If I understand, as a Hawaiian, if I understand telescope as something that's going to bring great humanity to people, it's going to feed the people, house the people, save some lives, especially in Hawaii, you know, that's the most important cultural concern. I can understand that. But when it's for pure selfish research, and with the idea that it doesn't really care or matter what Hawaiians feel or think, or a 2,000-year history here, or the fact that that mountain still belongs to a people, and they have the power and the privilege and the prejudice to ignore that. You know, this is really what it's about, you know, in the end. That if they actually saw us really as human beings and treated us as human beings, they would not move forward to do this to our people. But the truth is they will. You know, they will because they can. They will because they can, and they feel that their view of humanity outweighs, you know. And for me, it's no different than what happened in Bikini, Inuwatok, Rongelap. The same mentality. I mean, you wanna look at genetically modified food farming in Hawaii, it's the same thing. For me, self-determination is a key issue here. The protection of the people's rights to the humanity is also an important issue here. And of course, the protection of environment is also an issue here. So, you know, those are all really why we as Hawaiians, through the ideology of Aloha Aina, your love and appreciation and compassion for the land, leads us to do whatever it is necessary to come to here today to do whatever we have to do. So.
And that's tied to yesterday's action.
Of course, the TPP that we just had a protest on the beach. It's all really part of the same mentality, in a sense.
Like same
the
process. TPP.
Same process. Very secretive. The idea that the 1% of the 1% can determine for the rest of the 99.9% how things are going to be. That somehow their values, their desires outweigh our needs and our humanity. So, you know, to me, it's very similar. Basically, it is the same issue that's going on.
It's all tied together.
It's all tied. I mean, again, local self-determination. You know, so that's why we're here, to do whatever we need to do. So,
thank you for doing it.
Okay, brother?
Yeah.
Good. Okay.
All right.
In the EIS, if you look at the cultural impacts, you will see that overwhelmingly the Hawaiian community informed the Institute for Astronomy, the National Science Foundation, that we were overwhelmingly against the project. Avoidance, not minimization, no mitigation, avoidance. Don't build it. Please don't build it. We were comparing it to a 14-story structure anywhere on Maui. Could not be built. If you wanted to build a 14-story structure to house the houseless, you couldn't do it. So we turned to the Native Hawaiian Legal Corporation, and they have been our legal counsel. We've taken 4 lawsuits. We've won 2 of them. We have 2 awaiting right now. One was orally argued in front of the state Hawaii State Supreme Court in mid-December. We're waiting for results on that. And the second was argued in early April, and we're waiting on results for that.
And what case was successful?
We won two cases at the Intermediate Court of Appeals. Yeah. And so there was one that was a 2010 Board of Land and Natural Resources allowing for the permit, and the courts found in our favor and said that never should have happened. Subsequent to the 2010, a 2012 permit was granted, and that's the at issue right now.
And where does that stand? What legal cases are current?
The two that I just mentioned, they are surrounding whether or not the Board of Land and Natural Resources acted appropriately in its capacity to protect our aina, especially conservation district land, whether or not it fulfilled its own 8 criterion, and in the face of the overwhelming evidence that these are adverse long-term impacts on cultural and environmental resources, why did this happen? It should never have happened. That's our contention.
How long has this been going on?
The first public scopings started in 2005, and by 2007 we, Kilakila and Haleakala, realized that the Institute for Astronomy, the National Science Foundation, were being disingenuous, and that we really needed to do something. So Kilakila o Haleakala formed as a nonprofit. Nearing 10 years.
What kind of support have you seen from the community?
Oh, wonderful support. We know that the Institute for Astronomy, the National Science Foundation, National Solar Observatory is one group I've left out, feel they need to move forward with their project because they feel that they have the legal right to do so. But we have experienced overwhelming support for the project. And it's similar, it's not the same as, but it's very similar to what's happening on Mauna Kea. We're seeing a new generation, 20-somethings if you will, who are exhibiting leadership. And what they have realized is the long injustices against Hawaiians. You know, Kaho'olawe to me was more of a situation where we were dealing with military presence and desecration of the aina through military means. I think one of the things we're seeing right now, and this is just my personal take on it, is that this is about the haves and the have-nots of the world and global economies. The kinds of protests that I understand occurred yesterday with the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and the kinds of things that the new generation are realizing, people are willing to sacrifice the aina for their economic ends, and that's unacceptable. The mountains themselves, they are our ancestors, and our ancestors that we can trace to in human form believed in this. They passed those beliefs on to their descendants. That's us. Unfortunately, our collective, when I say our, basically Hawaiian, non-Hawaiian who understand and aloha aina, were disconnected from that understanding in an oppressive time of United States presence, the overthrow of the monarchy, and there have been many generations. So when people say, well, why didn't people step up earlier? It's because people are only coming to this realization recently. And it's a gestalt. Light bulbs are coming on in people's heads and saying, no, no more, no more.
Yeah, well, that kind of happens when they outlaw your language.
Exactly, Sam. Exactly, Sam.
My name is Camille Kalama. I'm an attorney with the Native Hawaiian Legal Corporation, and our office represents Kilakila o Haleakala, including Ki'ope, Raymond, and their group in challenging the right of the developer to build the, it's now called the Daniel K. Inouye Solar Telescope on Haleakala.
And what is the objection? What is the legal objection?
There are many, actually. We filed 4 cases on behalf of Kilakila. 2 have concluded, and we were victorious. The first case was about challenging the Board of Land and Natural Resources. They granted the Conservation District use permit to build the telescope before Haleakala had a chance at a hearing. And so that was the first challenge, a procedural challenge. It's like the judge making a decision before the trial. And that case, we were successful. The Supreme Court found in favor of Haleakala and said, yeah, that wasn't proper. The second case was a case where we had tried to get documents from the university. And that had to do with communications between the Senator Inouye's office and the Board of Land and Natural Resources, board members, and the hearings officer during our hearing. And so, in essence, putting political pressure before we'd had a chance for our fair hearing to be done. And the university refused to disclose those public documents. And we also, Haleakala won that court case. And actually had attorney's fees awarded to them for having to do that in the first place. Those two cases are finished. The third case was on the basis that the university had filed a management plan for Haleakala without first doing an environmental impact statement. So the Board of Land and Natural Resources accepted that plan according to their rules. That kind of plan must be done, and essentially the environmental impact statement, as we argued, would have looked at, you know, what is the carrying capacity for Haleakala versus an impact statement that looks at only one telescope or one project. You know, the idea is that these studies must be done to look at the comprehensive nature of what's happening on the Mauna and analyze that as a whole, rather than piecemeal. And that wasn't done, and the board agreed that that didn't need to be done. That case was argued before the Supreme Court in December of last year, and we're still waiting for a decision for Haleakala in that case. The last case happened after the contested case hearing that Haleakala went through on the Conservation District use permit. So you have to think of it like there's two permits. One was issued, we fought a case on that. It was eventually determined that that first permit that the BLNR granted in 2010 was declared invalid in 2014. The second case is after the contested case hearing happened, the board again issued a permit in favor of the ATST, now the DKSIST, and that was after the hearing. So they granted it before, they granted it after, nobody was surprised. And then Haleakala appealed that permit as well. So we treated it as a separate permit. That case is now with the Supreme Court. It was argued in February of this year, and we're waiting for the court decision on that case. April 2nd of this year, yeah. So the court hasn't made its decision yet, and the basis of our of the lawsuit for Haleakala is, there are many, actually. One was the procedural issues that we had, the unfairness that came from issuing a permit and then having a hearing, then issuing the same permit. The political influence that happened during that hearing. And finally, on the substance of the law, because this telescope will be built in the Conservation District. Conservation District is supposed to be the least developed of all the zones. You know, you have urban, agriculture, rural, and conservation. And even in the more developed zones, for the most part, residences and houses can only be 25 to 35 feet, depending where they are, tall. The tallest buildings, I believe, are allowed are 12 stories. And the ATST or DKIST is going to be 14 stories tall, or a little over 14 stories tall. So I think that that's important for people to realize for both Haleakala and Mauna Kea, is that the telescopes are massive. You know, this is going to be 50 feet higher than any existing observatory or structure on the Mauna today. So it's considerably higher. That's 5 stories taller. It also has support buildings and a wastewater treatment facility. they'll be using hazardous chemicals, and this is supposed to be conservation of a protected resource, an important spiritual place, a sacred place to our people. They call it Science City. The university calls it Science City in a conservation zone. So, I mean, the scary part is if you can allow the most industrialized area in the most protected zone, what isn't going to be allowed somewhere else? You know, what are we really protecting? Haleakala requested an injunction from the courts 4 times, and were denied every time. And it really makes it difficult for, you know, the citizens, for people who are just out there fighting for the good of everyone, really, when the state doesn't do its job, and then they're forced to fight these court cases, which are expensive in the cost alone. And in order to get an injunction, the courts sometimes will order a bond. So in other words, like, you have to ensure that you can cover the potential damage from the telescope being delayed by however long the injunction lasts. So it's just very difficult to be able to get that injunction. And what happens is then you, if we win in the court case eventually, now you now have this structure that maybe should never have been built. And at least according to us and Haleakala, it shouldn't have been built. And so what do you do? And you end up with that institutional inertia, you know, that the movement and the investment now pushes more investment and more development. And it just makes it very difficult to have justice or to have the law decided on what's right.
It doesn't seem reasonable to have to put up a bond to cover damages to a project that may be inappropriate and may eventually be stricken down. It's like the TPP that's going on now, where a corporation will be able to sue for potential losses because of a social action, political action.
Right. I mean, it's just... It makes it really hard for us to have justice done, you know. It's discouraging. It's a deterrent to people from fighting these types of cases. And it's really frustrating when they're really fighting on behalf of not themselves personally, you know. Haleakala, none of them are going to benefit personally from seeing this stopped. It's for really the good of Hawaii.
Prognostication of how it's all going to turn out?
It's really difficult to predict that. There's a lot of different issues that could come up. It could be decided on a procedural ground and may go back to the board for yet another hearing. It will be difficult for us to have a fair hearing, you know, especially when the telescope is in progress. So it's just hard to tell, but it could have effects that also impact what's happening on Mauna Kea. That's possible as well.
There doesn't seem like there is a middle ground where all sides would be satisfied.
In this case, I don't see that either. I mean, it's really, yeah, the sides are too far apart. It's not something where you could say build it halfway or, you know, build it a quarter way. I mean, and that's never been on the table from the beginning. Not that it would be considered, but I was at one of the first consultations with Kiope, or not one of the first ones, but one of the many. And there was actually a list of all the things that were not going to be discussed, including the height, the size, the color. It's going to be bright white. Well, apparently they've now changed the color after that was not an option to change. But there was never any question of the size or any talk of building it differently or building it elsewhere. It was, we've spent years planning it here. This is where it's going to be. We think it's legal. We're going to build it.
You need absolutely no concessions.
Yeah.
None.
So it's, you know, oftentimes put on, you know, folks like Kiope to say, well, what were you guys compromised for? But they don't have anything to give. You know, they're not in control of this. It's not their project. It's really not a fair question, because it becomes, let us do this and we'll give you scholarships, or we'll find other ways to compensate or do things that don't actually address the harm that's happening on the mountain.
If we have just some basic ground rules, I think it will be okay for everyone. So those of you that are interested, please meet myself and the legal observers over here by the High Hawaii, by the flag, and I'll be seeing you around this evening. We'll be giving you updates as we can periodically, okay? So, mai hila hila. 10 o'clock is when their permit is for, and so at 10, we expect some action going on, a little bit of energy going on over there. So let's just keep an eye on each other. Those that have keiki, let's just keep the keiki together. It is fairly dark, even though we have a full moon, but we want to keep everybody safe. And so again, mahalo everybody for coming, and we'll give you the next update when we have one.
Whether you are planning to sacrifice yourself or not, find a buddy, yeah? Find someone that knows your phone number, you have their phone number, and especially if you have keiki. If you have keiki and you are arrested, whether you want to be or not, if there's no one there to malama your keiki, they will call CPS, the police. So keep that in mind, yeah? And it's a dangerous area, so watch them closely. The other thing is, as far as warnings, If they give a warning and you move and you come back, they don't gotta give you another warning. And they didn't do that recently either. They gave chances. That doesn't mean they're not gonna give multiple warnings. They might do it in the beginning. And HPD up there gave many warnings. But when the other officers came, they started giving one and then they were done. Whether you heard it, whether you could hear it, because there was a lot of noise, they were grabbing people. So, they were getting people before everybody thought, oh, we're gonna have a chance to move. And that wasn't always the case. So be prepared. There were people who weren't ready for that, weren't planning on it, were walking away, and ended up down at the police station without anyone to call or to bail them out.
And remember, if they grab you, please do not resist, okay? Just sit down.
Those of you who have made the commitment to do whatever is necessary to stop the transportation of that equipment up to Haleakala, remember the key issue that we have the power of truth and the power of aloha. That's the key. Truth is on our side. Aloha, aloha aina oia io, is the means by which we will be victorious. So even if they get through tonight, it's one chapter in this long book. The good thing about this book is it's getting better. This is not the last chapter of the book. The fact that many of you and many of you young Opiu are here tonight tells me, shows me, demonstrates to me that we are ready as a people to do whatever is necessary to be a people. See, only us, people of Hawaii, can make ourselves, can demand that we be treated with equality as human beings in this place, on this earth, in our own land. Only us. So yes, it's a struggle, but as the saying goes, there's no struggle, there's no progress. Words of Frederick Douglass. The key is to have courage. The key is courage. And the way we get courage is the integrity of our cultural beliefs, the integrity of understanding who we are. And we must do this for those who cannot. We need to do this for those who have yet to learn. Because the truth is, our people are waking up. You know, they're saying, "Ea mai Hawaii nui a kea. Ea mai loko mai o ka pō. Wo pau ka pō wa o ka kō." The darkness is over. We're going to let truth be the guide. And the courage we find in now is going to lead us to do whatever is necessary to do. But at all times, we will do it with aloha. That's the key. And this is something, as I said, that the world will see. This is something that the world will know, that our people have awoken from this long sleep. In Haleakala, Mauna Kea, and other lands, this is just the beginning. So I'm proud of all the Opiu here and all those faces here who came out tonight, especially those who are sleepy. Because this is not reading history in the books. This is us living the history. Just like back in 1897, when our kupuna faced what occurred in 1897, they never went away and cried. They organized, set forth the Kuwait petitions, and they won the attempted annexation. And it's because of their work back then, we still have the work today. So for me, whatever we do, when we sing with pride. When we chant with pride. Because we know we have truth. Aloha aina oia io. We know we have love for this place. And that's our guide. So if those who get arrested, make sure we remember that. We gotta be disciplined. We gotta understand, yes, it can get emotional. But we need to smile, be proud. Let the world know that we're not fearful. We're not afraid. We're not running, we're not cowards. That in fact, we are proud. Proud to do what we need to do. Oh. You know, the kamaʻai na kekui, this is for the next and the following generations. This is just one of the struggles. So for me, happy birthday to all of us. The birth of our people, the rebirth. And for those who are not getting arrested, it's just important that discipline, that encouragement, sense of pride, support, showing our love for those who may not even have love for us. See, that's the key. And so, as we get ready, for those of us who are committed to do whatever we need to do, let's get focused, let's get ready, let's get happy, let's get proud. And when we sing our hearts out. And we chant, we let them know we chanted. Because, like our kupuna, we listen to the na'au, right here. It's telling us what we need to do. So I'm very, very proud, happy, and I'm ready. So, ma kau kau. Ea!
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 Kanaka haole oi! Ale hiki oe ki manawa, ke ike. Ale hele I loko ko lolo.
Several people have been arrested. Folks are traveling to another location to try and stop them there. So we're going to pick up the trail and see what we can see. And we'll bring that to you here on Maui Causes.
We've come up through Makawao and have gotten ahead of the caravan. They're headed up the Haleakala Highway. They turned up country at the high school, and they're now approaching our vantage point. They're stopping, but happy to be slowing them down, whatever the reason. Thank you. I guess that's a postscript on our story. Thank you for watching this episode of Maui Causes. Happy to bring you these kinds of stories that you're not going to see other places in the media here in Maui. Please support Maui Causes. Go to mauicauses.org and participate with us in supporting Maui's not-for-profits, environmental, and progressive causes. Aloha.
This program is brought to you as a public service by Maui Causes. Maui Causes is a crowd-funded media production group that provides media production services to a variety of environmental and progressive causes here in Maui County. Visit us on the web at www.mauicauses.org.